I'm going to call the Public Works Committee meeting to order and for everyone to lock the doors and let no council members out. Well, you're good. Thank you. 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, no, there it goes again. 1, 2. Well, I've started the committee. I'll have to wait until we get a quorum to vote on anything, but for those in the...
Do you have a letter of support for 1301?
I think so, yes. We're going to have a long consent calendar, and I'm going to read those numbers out, and then I'll read the captions. It's Resolution 1362, 1370, and 1371, and it's also going to include ordinances on second reading, ordinances 1297, 98, 99, 1300, 1301, 1302, 1303, and 1304. Does anyone have any objections to those not being on a consent calendar? I'll read those very quickly. Resolution 1362, authorize the director of public property or is designated to exercise an option agreement for the purchase of two flood properties located at 119 and 121 Commerce Street for Metro Water Services. Oops. Resolution 1370 by Council Lady Vircher authorizes Metro Water to enter into contract with TDOT for access to TDOT GNSS reference network. Resolution 1371 by Council Lady Vircher accepts a Keep America Beautiful / Lowe's Community Partner Grant to Metro Public Works to plant trees and daffodils at public schools during Hands-on Nashville Day. Let's see, not that one. Ordinance 1297 by Councilman Roten authorizes Metro Water to enter into agreement with KJPL Riverwood LLC to fund the operation and maintenance of a public pressure sewer extension for its development at the Village of Riverwood, Phase 2. Ordinance 1298 by Council Lady Vircher authorizes the acquisition of certain right-of-way easements, drainage easements, temporary construction easements, and property rights by negotiation or for purposes of public works project, Brewer Drive sidewalk improvements. Ordinance 1299 by Councilman Pulley abandons existing sanitary sewer main and easements and to accept new sanitary sewer main, a sanitary sewer manhole, and easements for property located at 4000 Hillsborough Pike. Ordinance 1300 by Council Lady Murphy abandons existing sanitary sewer main and easements for properties located at 211 and 231 Ensworth Place. Ordinance 1301 by Councilman Withers, abandoning existing sanitary sewer main and easement and to accept new sanitary sewer mains, sanitary sewer manholes, fire hydrants, and easements for six properties located at South 6th Street. Ordinance 1302 by Councilman Kendall and others authorizes Metro to remove any existing sanitary sewer mains and sanitary sewer manholes and to replace with new sanitary sewer manholes and sanitary sewer manholes within the existing public utility easements and for property located at 2300 Patterson Street. Ordinance 1303 by Councilman Withers abandons a portion of Alley 451 right-of-way and easement. Ordinance 1304 by Councilman O'Connell abandons a portion of Magazine Street right-of-way. And that is the consent agenda. 1, 2, 3, 4. And let's see. Yep. All right. We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All right. All those in favor? And we recommend approval. And that brings us to. Let's see, Councilman Rosenberg's ordinance, we'll move that to the Hill. We are now on ordinance 1295 by Councilman O'Connell. Amends Metro Code section 1308.040b6f to add Symphony Place to the designated rights of way upon which street vendors shall not be permitted to operate within the DTC and CF districts subject to limitations of chapter 1308. And we have a proposed substitute, Councilman O'Connell.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is something that first was requested by the Symphony, if you ever spent any time down on Symphony Place, I think the entire design of that is, yes, it's a public space, but it's also kind of a unique public space that was part of the creation of the Symphony. And so this is basically a way to limit the kind of It fits into some guidelines that are there on Lower Broadway to kind of preserve the overall character of that, and then to the substitute effectively just extends that all the way up to the Siegenthaler pedestrian bridge, just to make, you know, we've got a ton of active places downtown on public rights of way where people with permits can participate in vending, and this is basically just looking to kind of wrap that restriction that exists for Lower Broadway already kind of around to Symphony Place into the bridge. And so I would move approval.
Moves approval of the substitute. Seconded. Any discussion?
Sorry, I guess I'd move the bill as or move the substitute.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Any opposed? And we recommend approval. No. We recommend approval as substituted.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
All right, and that brings us to Councilman Rosenberg. We'll may take him up when he comes in. But on the last item on our agenda, after going through all the items that were on the consent, is the ordinance that was on third reading, ordinance 1280 by Councilman Hastings. And I'll let you start us off.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. We're getting ready for a very long and exciting night here. I would like to move for a deferral and for one meeting until September 4th and with a brief explanation.
All right, we've got, I'll make the motion for one deferral to the first meeting in September. And then we may have some testimony from the applicant, but I want to go and, yes, sir, Councilman Hastings.
Yes, this is a different bill that is before us because it deals with the Jackson Law. It's more legal. There is not an up or down vote on this. There's not a place in this area for us to be able to stop development, especially when land is already zoned for this development. It is something that is tedious, but I want to make sure that my constituents in the second district are heard, and they have the opportunity to see the overall things that are out there with the overall development that is looking to come forth, and as well as to see if any changes that could happen with this development, that they happen and they are legally written down, and to make sure that these things are taken care of. So with that, again, I would move to defer until September 4th, which is my anniversary. But I guess we'll be here going over on the third reading of this bill. And we'll move and look forward to going and making sure that this bill is where it needs to be.
Okay. We've got that motion and a second on the floor. And to let everyone know where we are procedurally, of course, this is the Jackson Law that we spent some time on and whether or not to adopt it as the way for Metro to handle these types of facilities. And so we have to go by the process that's laid out in state code, specifically TCA 6820-211 704B. And in that statute, there are eight criteria that we have to look at essentially, and then however we decide whether we approve it or disapprove it, someone can appeal our decision to Chancery Court, is that right? To Chancery Court of Davidson County, and that court will then look at the same criteria that we have to, and essentially look at it totally brand new from what that we have. So they can add or subtract, but they can look at it totally new. So I think it's important for us as a committee, and most importantly as a council, to at least know what these factors are, and to I think go through them as much as possible, or at least perhaps in total discuss them. The type of waste to be disposed at a waste at the landfill, the method of disposal to use at the landfill, the projected impact on surrounding areas from noise and odor created by the proposed landfill, the projected impact on property values and surrounding areas created by the proposed landfill, the adequacy of existing roads and bridges to carry the increased traffic projected to result from the proposed landfill, the economic impact on the city, county, or both, the compatibility with existing development or zoning plans, and any other factor which may affect the public health, safety, or welfare. So we have seven somewhat specific factors, but then a catch-all at the end. So I've asked, basically, it's the burden upon the applicant to prove it. So while we have a deferral, because we're essentially the committee that's going to be looking at this, I've talked to the attorney for the for the applicant, and so Mr. White, would you mind giving and just perhaps going through some of these factors or anything else that you'd like for the committee to know?
Chairman, thank you. Tom White, 315 Dedrick Street. I'd like to ask at the front end just a point of order in that I think this committee has deferred this matter once already, and unless I'm mistaken, I think the committee needs to hear this tonight, and third and final reading on the bill is to be on September 4th. If I'm incorrect about that, somebody let me know. I know the council person is going to defer third and final reading from tonight to September 4, but shouldn't the Public Works Committee consider this matter tonight? If not,
I believe we can. It has to have some kind of committee action before third reading. I think we can defer committee action until the next. But someone's better educated about this than I, Mr. James.
Under the state legislation, the third and final has to be within 30 days of the public hearing. You do not need committee recommendation until third and final reading.
That's fine.
So, Mr. Ryan, you know, we talked earlier, so anything you'd like to for the committee to know?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Basically, the issue that came up on the floor when this matter was on public hearing was the very issue which you raised tonight, and that is what's required by the Jackson Law. Mr. Jameson that night and you tonight cited the specific section. And I've sent out a position paper to the members of Public Works that deals with those eight conditions. The basic background is that where the site's currently located, it's inconsistent with the land use policy, and it's basically a business that has 100 trucks a day on about 30 residential streets. The proposed site is off Briley Parkway. There is basically no residential traffic, and it's consistent with the land use policy. But to go to the eight issues that were mentioned, I addressed those very briefly, do this in less than 5 minutes. But the first one, which was attached as an exhibit to my handout, was the type of waste to be disposed. It's non-hazardous liquid, period. It's oil, it is grease from restaurants, and it's leachate. That's the type. Number two is the method of disposal to be used. Trucks will come into the new site. It's all to be mandated by TDEC to be indoors. So the trucks will come inside, the door will close, the materials will be unloaded, it'll be recycled within the facility, and then taken out by truck at some later point. But it's all indoor. It's mandated to be basically odor-free outside. The projected impact on surrounding areas from noise and odor, there will be no odor other than within the building itself, no odor outside. With respect to noise, it's basically de minimis noise where the trucks pull up into this respective warehouse. The impact on property values, I would urge the committee to consider the fact that the zoning in the area, and the members of the committee and the council have gotten a letter from Lucy Kemp and Bill Herbert, clearly states that in a District B, which is what will be mandated for this site, this type of use is allowed. So planning normally considers property values when they allow uses in the area. This is a use that is directly across the street from a quarry and a lot of other industrial uses. With respect to the number five, the adequacy of existing roads, it's off Briley Parkway. There's no question but that it is an excellent road use for this purpose. With respect to the economic impact, the client has got an excellent track record of employing from the local community. It will be expanded. More people will be hired. The additional property and sales tax are very significant, which we have discussed with the members of this committee. With the consistency of existing development or zoning plans, this is not a zone change. It's already allowed under District B, as you've seen from Lucy Kemp and Bill Herbert. Finally, any other factors which affect public health, safety, and welfare, that's kind of a repeat of where I began, and that is it's an odor-free, all-indoor operation mandated. It's non-hazardous liquid. It is clearly not opposed by our Public Works Department, and we think is environmentally something that should be considered. Appreciate your courtesies and would urge the committee to favorably act on this matter when it comes up on third and final on September 4. Thank you for the time, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. White. We are going to we are not adjourning or recessing, but we're going to wait for our quorum to come back so we can take an action on this ordinance and on Councilman Rosenberg's scooter ordinance. So the motion on the floor, as soon as we get one more council member, will be a one-meeting deferral from the Public Works Committee, and then that will be the last meeting that we can consider it to be in compliance with the Jackson Law. And I think also with our rules, because there's no other committee that this has been to, and there has to be some kind of, there has to be a committee take action on the ordinance, and so that will satisfy that as well. Mr. Hastings, do you have anything that you want to add? Or Councilman Hastings, excuse me.
Yes, Mr. Chair, I just wanted to mention within the information, just to let everyone know, this is not a landfill. I was actually one of the individuals that brought up the Jackson Law on this floor to stop landfills from coming within our corridor and our neighborhoods. This is not a landfill. There are other things that are coming forth with this as well. There are some retail developments that are moving forward as well that will be attached or around this facility. I think that we need to get the right information out there for our residents and our community to understand and to be able to move and to want to go forward with this legislation, if any. But as I say, I look forward to moving forward and getting to the constituents of District 2 so that they will know the truth, not secondhand information, but the truth, and being able to move forward like never before, basically. Thank you.
I'm sorry, Councilman Bednay. My apologies. You're recognized.
I'm just too far away from you.
Yeah, you are, and I hate that. I hate it when you're far away from me. So go ahead.
I just want to repeat the question I asked Councilmember Hastings at the last council meeting. You ask for time to do something, and now you're asking for a deferral, and I want to get some clarity of what is that. I mean, the people were so adamantly against the request, so I just wonder what is the objective of the deferral, and how will that help you change that attitude from your constituency?
Thank you, Mr. Councilman Bedney. There are a lot of things that are out there, and a lot of constituents. First of all, everyone that spoke the night, and I appreciate the constituents for coming out to be able to speak, but everyone that spoke on that night were not actually constituents of District 2. That was a group that was a part, and they came out to make their voices heard, evidently. But nevertheless, my opportunity right now is to allow the overall development or whomever else that's a part of this, because this is not my deal. I have the opportunity to be the councilman of one of the greatest districts that are in Nashville, which is District 2. With this legislation, the community that was a part of the Haynes Manor neighborhood, as well as the former councilman, had an opportunity, and they went forward without the planning proposal. The planning department did not necessarily go along with the zoning, the change of zoning during that period of time, but they did. There are several things that are part of that that area that are there. It's for some retail space, for some IWD space, some other things that to go along. The community has not had the opportunity, and we're looking for them to also get the opportunity to sit down. If they can't hear from me, or if they can, or whatever, to be able to sit down with our legal to allow them to have a better understanding. The Jackson Law is a hard thing for us, so I don't necessarily expect them to understand off the back on what's going on. This is not a land use thing. This is not a thing of just changing land zoning. This is the first that's been on this floor that we're dealing with the Jackson Law, and I think we need more time into making sure that they understand correctly on what is actually going on with this particular bill. Thank you.
All right. Is there any other discussion? So we'll this is for a one-meeting deferral. All those in favor say aye. Any opposed? And we defer for one meeting. Now we're back on Councilman Rosenberg's ordinance. Let me get the number right. Substitute ordinance 1203 by Councilman Rosenberg amends the Metro Code relating to scooters, inline skates, and roller skates by defining scooter and removing certain requirements. Councilman Rosenberg.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is the bill that affects, as substituted, would affect scooters besides the SUMDs. Currently, Section 1258 applies to skates and all scooters, whether they're kids' razor scooters or unshared motorized scooters or shared motorized scooters. This would modify it to, first of all, not speak to the SUMDs. Those would all be handled in this single piece of code that's our single piece of code that's addressed in the ordinance on third reading tonight. It would also treat motorized and non-motorized scooters a little bit differently. The motorized scooters, as far as where it could go on sidewalks and that sort of thing, would be exactly the same as SUMDs. Non-motorized scooters would be treated a little more leniently, prohibited from sidewalks in central business improvement districts, but not other business districts, which is similar to what it is right now. Right now, the area where it cannot be used on a sidewalk is a random area of downtown inside of specifically defined boundaries. And it also removes the restriction on things like wrist guards and knee pads that currently apply to all scooters, including SUMDs. So I would ask that you adopt the substitute and, pending any questions, approve. Thank you.
We have a motion and a second. Councilman Rosenberg, can I listen to my boombox now?
You absolutely can.
Awesome. All right, any further discussion? All those in favor say aye. Any opposed? And we recommend approval. That's everything that I have on the agenda.
Mr. Chairman.
Oh. I'm sorry.
That was putting the substitute on?
Yes.
Okay.
So all those now in favor of the ordinance as substitute, excuse me. All those in favor say aye. Any opposed? And now we have recommended approval. Anything else before the committee? All right, we'll stand adjourned. Thank you all.
This has been a service of the Metro National Network. If you would like to see this presentation again, or for more information about this and other programs, visit nashville.gov.